Hi, this is Herb Kressel, and welcome to the July Radiology Podcast. I'll be speaking with Professor Van Rossum from Amsterdam, who with his colleagues looked at the effectiveness of cell therapies in improving cardiac perfusion in patients with myocardial infarction. The results of this study and others suggested that a lot more work needs to be done in bringing cell therapies as a clinical reality. And finally, I'll be speaking with Drs. Matthew Davenport and Richard Barron. Dr. Davenport and colleagues at the University of Michigan performed a study looking at the repeatability of findings on the different scoring systems in patients evaluated for hepatocellular carcinoma. And Dr. Barron wrote a very provocative editorial on the issue of structured reporting in this application and looking at these systems. So I found these discussions quite fascinating and hope that you all will enjoy them as well. Herb Kressel, and welcome to the Radiology Podcast. Today, I'm joined with Dr. Albert Van Rossum, who's professor of cardiology at the Free University Medical Center in Amsterdam. And Dr. Van Rossum and colleagues published an important study looking at cell therapy in reperfused acute myocardial infarction. And this study noted that the therapy doesn't improve the recovery of perfusion in the infarcted myocardium. And this is a very controversial subject, and we'll be very anxious to hear from Dr. Van Rossum on his work and his findings. Welcome, Dr. Van Rossum.
Thank you, Dr. Kressel, and welcome you too.
Okay. How long have you and your group been interested in cell therapies?
Well, for us, that started about in 2006, 2007, when we tried to start up real clinical trials in patients after the animal studies had been done and showed some positive results, which were in fact an argument for trying now to use this approach in a really clinical setting with patients.
I see. And can you just bring us up to date currently? What would people think were the main indications for cell therapy in heart disease?
Well, there is several, I think. One of them, which was done in this study, is in acute myocardial infarction, STEMI, ST segment elevation myocardial infarction. The other one is maybe in heart failure, in the more stable situation in which you have coronary artery disease and you want to sort of regenerate the failing heart by using cell therapy. I think these are the main two subjects.
And if I understand that there are a number of different cell types that have been used, and so can you just, a lot of the listeners are not familiar, can you tell us about the issues in choosing the cell type that's appropriate?
Well, the cell types that we used were mononuclear cells that we extracted from the bone marrow, and this is the most widely applied administration or use of stem cells. But we also extracted them from peripheral blood, and for example, in this institution, we are also working on stem cells derived from adipose tissue. So there's several of them that you can use. And so we targeted at these two, the mononuclear cells from the bone marrow and from the peripheral blood.
If I remember correctly, when this started, people were just injecting this directly. But now I think there are a number of different ways that people have administered the stem cells. What is the current preferred approach?
Well, as we used in this study, the preferred approach at that time when we started this study was, or we believed mostly in the directly intracoronary infusion, which was used in our study. But there has also been studies which used intramyocardial injection, so into the myocardium, either from the outside or from the endocardium, or even intravenous administration, which is of course easier.
Right. So now, getting to your study directly, what was the hypothesis of your study?
Well, the hypothesis of this, well, let me just give you an explanation of what was going on.
Yeah.
Because these clinical trials, we started them at that time, many people did, and we started them because at the bench in the animal studies, it was shown that there was an effect, and this was really published in major journals, that there was a positive effect on the recovery of the myocardium by administrating stem cells, either by regeneration through, proliferation of cardiomyocytes, or by inducing angiogenesis, which then would improve the recovery of the myocardium. And so we were very hopeful that starting to apply that in patients, we would have that beneficial effect. However, the results of many of these studies turned out to be, well, either inconclusive or slightly moderate. So there was an improvement of ejection fraction, and this has been shown by several meta-analyses now, of about between 2 and 3%, which is only very moderate, and it's probably not worth all the efforts. But at that time, we didn't know that.
Sure.
And so we performed this Herbert trial, which was performed in acute myocardial infarction directly after PCI. Patients were randomized to three treatment arms. One was the bone marrow cells from the bone marrow cell therapy. The other one was the peripheral mononuclear cell therapy. And the third arm was conventional, well, standard therapy, which was the control situation for the other two therapies. And in this Herbert trial, we ended up by finding no effect. So we were one of the studies that had a negative result. But at the time that we developed the sub-study for the perfusion in this infarction, we thought we would have a positive effect. We were intrigued by what would be the mechanism behind that improvement. And since there is a neoangiogenetic effect of the stem cells, we expected that perfusion would improve, we could show an improvement of perfusion, which we did not at the end.
Okay. So in the current study was really looking at the perfusion, and then the thought that comes to mind, since there wasn't a change in systolic function originally, the thought was, well, why not do sort of a more of stress perfusion rather than resting perfusion in the current study? But it sounds like you planned that before you knew the definitive results in the first study. Is that correct?
Exactly. You're exactly right. I mean, this was planned beforehand, and we didn't think of looking at the contractile reserve or by doing one sort of a sort of stress test in stimulation.
And then conceptually, your expectation and the improvement, let's say there was a neoangiogenesis, was it thought that it would be diffuse or it would be more localized to the periphery, or what's known about that?
Well, the idea is that the stem cells would home into the injured myocardium.
Yeah.
And this is probably problematic. We don't really know if this is happening.
I see.
And we expect that to happen, but it might well be that when you inject them in specifically in a coronary artery which leads to the infarcted area, that this homing is not in fact occurring adequately, and that many of these stem cells might even be flushed away, so to speak, instead of getting into these injured myocardium and then having their positive effect.
Right. Well, and perhaps you can review with us the main findings of your study. When we were speaking earlier, we talked about how unusual it is to publish a negative result. And the thing that I mentioned to you was that, you know, we talk about publication bias, but looking at it from an editor's perspective, the problem that we see is that a lot of the studies that are not showing a positive finding are not well done. And in your case, the study was beautifully designed and beautifully performed. I want to compliment you on that. And I think I'm aware of all the controversy, and it's kind of not so easy to come up with a negative result in something that is so popular and appears to be so promising. So congratulations, and just kind of review with us what you actually did find with the study.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for your compliments. But I think that, so what we found was within the area of infarcted myocardium, we performed three short exercises to measure perfusion. And we then measured the perfusion by a semi-quantitative analysis by signal intensity versus time curves, and we measured the slope. And we found that in the core of the infarct zone, perfusion was lower than in the border zone of the infarct. And this was even, and in the normal myocardium, the remote myocardium, perfusion was even above normal, okay, somewhat above normal. And at follow-up, which was done at 4 months, we observed that these differences still remain. I mean, the core of the infarct still showed a lower perfusion slope than the border zone, and the remote myocardium had the best perfusion slope. And in fact, none of the cell therapies had any influence on the recovery. So there was no difference between either the bone marrow cell therapy group, the peripheral blood cell therapy group, and the standard care group. Mm-hmm. So all of these had the same effect. The perfusion in these regions had a similar development at follow-up, regardless of the type of therapy that was used. So in fact, the cell therapy here was negative, the use of the cell therapy.
I see. And I've sort of been following this somewhat in the lay press as well. And I know there was a spate of papers actually showing the same thing, the lack of effectiveness of the cell therapy. And so this brings me sort of to sort of the take-home lesson for all of this. What do you think we learn in the pure research experiment you perform, but what are the lessons in translational medicine in trying to bring to the clinic promising advances in stem cells, or we're seeing a lot in molecular-based therapies and molecular imaging. You know, the issue of the gap in findings in the bench to clinical utility in the bedside is large. And I think there are a lot of laboratory advances that are having great difficulty in translation. So I wonder what your thoughts are on this and where we should go from here.
Yes. Well, I think, in fact, looking retrospectively, we jumped too quickly to the clinical setting of using it.
Yeah.
We saw these positive results in animal studies, but didn't look really at what the factors were that made it occur, and we didn't translate that well to the clinical setting, I think. And so, for example, the way of preparing the stem cells, the time the time between preparing the stem cells and delivering them to the body, the type of stem cells, all of these factors, I think, should have been watched more carefully at before introduced in the clinical setting. However, it's not completely negative, though, the results.
Right.
We still see an effect, but it's very small. The ejection fraction improvement with cell therapy compared to non-cell therapy is about 2.5%, as we discussed.
Okay.
And so there is probably somewhere an effect, but we haven't put the finger on the right spot to see what is the thing that really makes it happen.
You know, so much in our current existence time, the speed of everything has accelerated.
Yes.
And so I think there may be wishful thinking that we can accelerate the translation. But in point of fact, I think we're seeing this in a number of areas where biology is a lot of slow, considered work. And that when you jump to conclusions, there's a good chance that you may not land where you thought you were going to land.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I think you're completely right. And homework should be better done before jumping into the clinical setting, as was done in this case.
And we've seen that with the gene therapy as well. If you remember, they were very anxious to implement it, and just a lot of the nuance that may well affect performance is not fully evaluated.
Yes. Of course, it's a pity if by that we would completely close the book and say it's not working at all. So we have to be careful for that and see if we can still make improvements. So for example, in stem cells, the paracrine effects have been probably underestimated. And we now think that these effects might play a role.
Okay.
And there's probably more in that can still be worked out.
So trying to sort of amplify, creating situations where those can be amplified might be a reasonable way to go.
Yes.
Okay, well, Professor Van Rossum, it was a pleasure chatting with you. Congratulations on your work. There's so much promise in cell therapy in general that one hopes that we will use what we learn and further develop this area. Thank you so much for your participation.
Thank you very much.
This is Herb Kressel, and welcome to the Radiology Podcast. This morning we'll be dealing with a very thought-provoking study, and I'm joined by Dr. Matthew Davenport, Assistant Professor of Radiology at the University of Michigan, who with his colleagues did a study on the repeatability of major diagnostic features and scoring systems for hepatocellular carcinoma using dynamic contrast-enhanced magnetic resonance imaging. Welcome, Dr. Davenport.
Thank you.
Also joining us today is Professor Richard Barron of the University of Chicago. Rich is a highly regarded expert on liver imaging, and Rich wrote a thought-provoking editorial on this work. Thanks for joining us, Dr. Barron.
Thanks for having me, Herb.
Okay. Matt, can you start off and tell us why did you actually do this study? What was the motivation?
Sure. So these scoring systems were designed for two major reasons. The first is that when we diagnose HCC by imaging, we want to make sure that we're always right, because if we're not going to get a tissue confirmation, the imaging has to just always be right. So that's 100% specificity is what we're looking for. And the second reason is because the scoring systems are trying to improve the coherency and the consistency of radiology reporting. And historically, we've had a lot of issues with people reporting things in different ways, which means the clinicians have a hard time understanding it, similar to how mammography reports were generated 20, 30 years ago. And we wanted to see how well do people agree when we employ these scoring systems? Are we getting the same results if we have three different people or 10 different people look at them?
And the which scoring systems did you look at? And could you tell us a little bit about those, the three of them?
Sure. OPTN scoring system is used to determine whether something's an HCC or not with respect to eligibility for transplantation of the liver. LIRADS, which is a relatively new scoring system designed by the ACR, which is designed for liver lesions of all types, not necessarily just HCC in patients who have chronic liver disease. And AASLD, which is the oldest of the three scoring systems, which also focuses primarily on trying to diagnose HCC.
Okay. Now, do you use all three at your institution? Were the people involved in the study familiar with all of them?
So at our institution, we use two of the systems primarily. We use LIRADS for everything between LR1 and LR4. And once something becomes a definite HCC by imaging, we revert to the OPTN system. So the macro we have in our reports includes both the LIRAD score and the OPTN score. And if the OPTN score is not met, it says deferred to LIRADS. We do not use the AASLD system.
And Dr. Barron, at your institution, are you using all three?
Well, we use them in our mindset as we work, but we don't put them officially in our reports.
Yeah, at our institution, I don't think we put them in our reports directly as well. So tell us a little more about the study design. So how did you select the cases? Apparently, there were 100 cases selected.
So we had a bunch of cases, around 500 or so, of patients who had chronic liver disease. And basically, I went through those cases and gave preliminary LIRAD scores to them on an integer basis, 1 through 5. And as soon as something met criteria for one of those LIRADS integers based on the scoring system, then I preliminarily assigned that score to that lesion. And I gave 20 into each of the integer categories before I distributed them to the readers.
Okay. And how many readers did you have?
10. There were 5 experts, people who had between 6 and 11 years of experience reading liver MR at a transplant center, and then 5 novices who were all radiology residents.
And do you think that there was any learning curve issues by yourself in terms of the assignments originally or the readers, and how did you deal with those?
So we tried to address the learning curve issue by having a preparatory educational session where everyone kind of got in a room together, and for about an hour, all the systems were presented. We discussed them. We discussed the differences between them, why the systems were different, how they were different. And so we sort of hashed that out ahead of time.
Now, can you tell us sort of what you found? What was the repeatability and the inter-observer variability? What were the general trends?
In general, we found that the OPTN system was the most repeatable of the three. The main reason for that is because the intermediate risk assessment scores, LIRADS 2, 3, and 4, and AASLD 2 and 3, which is a modified system, just were not very repeatable at all. They had fair to slight agreement. So I think that's the driver behind it. The other thing is that when you use ancillary features to adjust a LIRAD score, so T2 hyperintensity, intracellular lipid, any of these variety of ancillary features, which aren't specific features for HCC, but may be supportive of the diagnosis, every time you apply an ancillary feature, it actually negatively affects the repeatability.
Okay.
So with each assigned ancillary criterion, the repeatability became worse.
Now, you didn't look at this directly, but as I read the paper, the question comes up, you know, how much of this is human factors versus sort of nuances in technique? The cardiac output could affect things, the dose of contrast and the way it was given, the exact timing of the arterial phase and the washout phase acquisitions.
So I think what you're referring to are patient level and technology level sources of repeatability, which may be an issue if you had the same patient scanned several times or had multiple patients scanned several times, but we didn't really do that. We had everybody looking at the same pictures.
Mm-hmm.
So
I see.
Whatever problems or limitations inherent to the arterial phase of a particular patient, everybody was dealing with that same issue.
This is pure human factors. Rich, when you read the paper, were you surprised at these results?
Oh, not at all, Herb. You know, we've all experienced in seeing the trying to get two radiologists to agree first on what the requirements should be, and then second, interpreting them has shown great variability.
So from your point of view, Rich, if you're not surprised, should we throw out these scoring systems? What are the lessons that are learned here?
Oh, absolutely not, Herb. You know, I think we have a long history of radiology with reports often in the community that would say there is impression, there was. And we have obviously a long way to go, but I think the lessons are that we need to really pay attention to our communication, that nuances that radiologists can express in their reports can have dramatic impacts, as Dr. Davenport's expressed, on patient outcomes, and that we really need to go beyond thinking of this paper just as inter-reader variability and going back to the basics of how does radiology communicate with other specialties and other fields to really get our goal of patient outcome.
I see. And, you know, we've sort of had occasion recently to kind of go back and think about how the BI-RADS began and how the scoring system that we use for complex renal masses developed. And those were sort of done by, you know, in one case, one person, another, like a small group in a room. And they came up with these elegantly simple things, sort of on the back of an envelope, and then empirically it just worked out. And I think perhaps in a way we've been seduced by that because the world is more complicated, and a lot of the other important types of decisions that we make as imagers maybe have a lot more nuance and more potential for variability, and so we really need a more structured way of identifying these systems, validating them, and putting them out into the public. Matt, in your group, are you going to follow up on this? What are the implications for the research going forward?
So it's interesting because we wonder, what are we supposed to do with this information? We have these big scoring systems, and even the one that's used nationally, the OPTN system to disseminate transplants, a big deal. I mean, even that was not perfect. We still mm-hmm. had people disagreeing with each other on things. So fundamentally, there's an undercurrent here where we're relying on subjective features like arterial hyperenhancement, washout appearance, pseudocapsule. These are inherently subjective things to make major decisions on someone's life. And I wonder if we need to be more quantitative about it mm-hmm. to reduce this variability. I don't know how to do that exactly, but that's my first thought. The second thing is that our paper doesn't at all get at what are the outcomes for these categories. If I tell a patient or a doctor that I see an LR3 lesion, what does that mean? If I see an LR4 lesion, what does that mean? Or a 2? What does that mean? So does that mean that they can ignore? Do they have to biopsy? What's the management? So I think that the LIRAD system is an excellent, innovative first step, but needs a lot of work because we don't know what these categories predict. And right now there's just too much disagreement between the categories.
Now, Richard, we both go back a long ways in terms of using CT and MR for liver lesions. And, you know, you kind of allude to this in your editorial. The reference standard that we use evolves over time. You know, when we introduce these technologies, we're painting with a very broad brush, and then we sort of refine things over time. And I wonder what you think we should be doing in terms of developing a database that will ultimately be more suitable for structured reporting.
I'm not quite sure I understand your transition there, Herb. Can you clarify that a little bit more about going to structured reporting?
Well, you know, if the endpoint, if you're using an imperfect endpoint, right, clinical follow-up or something like that, you wind up with criteria that have a certain performance feature. We see that with the retrospective studies all the time. We start off and to get enough cases to analyze, the reference standard is non-optimal, okay? And to use an optimal, let's say like in the liver transplant I mean, it would take you years to gather that data, whereas people want to have sort of an early understanding of where the technology might fit in. And then if you're assigning structured reporting where you're making this finding means this, it depends on what data is the backbone for making those decisions. And if that is changing over time, it may have implications.
Yeah. So I now I see where you're heading. I think Dr. Davenport had the right concept when he said we really need to move not necessarily into linear measurables, but certainly at this stage, take subjective assessments and create mm-hmm. a quantitative score. And I think a great role model would be the prostate field, where the Gleason score, pathologists long ago took something totally subjective, very similar mm-hmm. to radiology, but created a reproducible way of communicating that's semi-quantitative, that allows one to communicate across geographic regions between physicians and practices. And I think the world of radiology needs to think that way into mm-hmm. the future, which is get out of our isolated world of just talking with each other and realize we have to talk with many different physicians across different geographies, specialties, and experience, and translate that language subjective into some semi-quantitative mm-hmm. way as the first step.
Good. And so, Rich, sort of looking at it more broadly from an organizational perspective, what do you think needs to be done in the future? Because more and more of these kind of structured reporting systems are being introduced. They're very, very valuable. I know the referring clinicians, surgeons, pathologists, they all value sort of having more reproducibility and decreasing variability through structured reporting. So what do you think we could do to make these offerings more effective when they're originally introduced?
Yeah, that's a thoughtful question that's difficult to answer. I think radiology has done a great job in an expanding 30-year history that we've never seen with new technologies being thrown at us. And I think we've done a marvelous job of seeing how fast we can implement them. But I think we need to move away from focusing our research on evaluating marginal, minimal, incremental technological changes and sort of counting the dots and mm-hmm. saying how good are we at counting dots, and go to what Matt talked about, is what's the impact on the patient and the impact we can have on care. And I think the only way to do that is to move much further away from the isolated radiology community and work much closer together in our research and our mm-hmm. communications, participate more in digestive disease week activities where they bring together pathologists, oncologists, surgeons, hepatologists, and really set up multidisciplinary clinical trials that will really evaluate the impact on mm-hmm. patients rather than focusing on the specific small issues we face in radiology.
Very, very interesting thought. So we're running out of time. I want to thank you both. Dr. Davenport, I thank you for a really provocative, well-done study. And I recommend all of our listeners read Dr. Barron's editorial. I learned a lot from reading it. And I thank you for participating, Dr. Barron.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.